Before I begin, I would like to acknowledge that we meet and learn from each other today on country. I live, work and write on Gadigal land, and I pay my sincere respect to Gadigal and all elders, past, present and emerging. I extend that respect to any Aboriginal Australians who might be with us here today. And today also, I would like to offer my respect to the First Nations people of North America, especially the area now known as Dakota, where our speaker comes from today. Hello, my name is Rachel Franks. I'm the coordinator of scholarship here at the library, and today is a very special scholar talk, and it's a great privilege to be able to welcome one of our international fellows to share their research with you today. Dr. Stephen Jackson was the Australian Religious History Fellow here at the Library in 2019, and he was researching some of the influences of religion upon the education systems in Australia, Canada, and New Zealand. If you have any questions that you would like Stephen to answer at the end of his talk today, please use the chat feature, and I'll be back at the end of the session to facilitate those questions for you. Dr. Stephen Jackson is an Associate Professor of History at the University of Sioux Falls, and he joins us now from the United States. Thank you, Stephen.
Well, thank you for that introduction, Rachel. I appreciate it. And thank you all for joining me for this talk entitled Tracing Religious Education Across an Empire, where I'll be going through some of the research that I did while I was at the State Library of New South Wales. And what I'm going to be doing today is sort of giving you a bit of an overview of a book project. This actually just came out about a month and a half ago called Religious Education and the Anglo World. I've got my copy right here. So the rest of the story can be found here. I'm gonna try to give you sort of a synopsis, a bird's eye view of what that project looked like. And I'll sort of explain what that means as we go along. Looking at three different countries across three different chronological time periods, it really does sort of provide an overview of how the British Empire affected the development of religious education in multiple locations. What place should religion have in education? I'll be discussing religious education in the publicly funded schools of Canada, Australia, and New Zealand. And as I mentioned, the main argument that I want to make today is that religious education in each case was shaped by participation in the wider British Empire. Now, to some of you, this may seem like an obvious connection, but for a variety of reasons, there's very little connecting scholarship that makes this point. And I want my work to change that. And I'm hoping that it will in turn sort of promote a new scholarly discussion on the many ways that religion shaped imperialism. Throughout, I'll rely on many of these sources, primary and secondary, found at the State Library. On average, we're basically talking about an hour of instruction per week, but boy, oh boy, did that hour prove to be enormously controversial in the late 19th and 20th centuries. And what I wanna do is I wanna start with a few examples that I found in my research. And these examples are taken from three different countries in three different time periods. And we'll start with New Zealand. In 1877, New Zealand passed an Education Act that controversially pronounced public primary education in the country to be secular. That's the official label of secular. Over the next 50 years, however, more than 42 unsuccessful attempts were made to change the legislation to allow for direct religious education in New Zealand classrooms. Undaunted by this repeated history of failure, Protestant groups developed the Nelson system in the 1890s, a creative loophole of, we should say, dubious legality, which advocated opening schools half an hour later or closing half an hour earlier to allow for denominational religious education when the school was not formally in session. The second example comes from a 1944 teacher's guide to religious education entitled Jesus and the Kingdom. And this was produced for grade 6 classes in Ontario, Canada. And it really resembles imperial adventure literature as much as a religious text. The author, Ernest Hayes, wanted to give students stories of heroic Christian adventure, as he called it. And he provided stories of Christian luminaries like William Wilberforce and David Livingstone. Livingstone, in fact, received a great deal of attention as the prime exemplar of Christian missionary service. The book went on to praise European dominance in Africa, which, according to the guide, brought peace to the continent, ended the slave trade, and was worthy of praise. The third example comes from a 1981 report on religious education in the Australian Capital Territory. The report noted that one of the three most widely used curricula in the ACT was the Birmingham's Agreed Syllabus of 1975, described by the author Graham Rossiter as a broad pluralist approach to religious education. Now, that syllabus developed 6 years earlier to meet the needs of an increasingly diverse English industrial city, and it's a watershed document in the history of religious education in England. That within just a few years, this very specifically English curricula was adopted in Australian schools is, I think, very revealing. So this should bring to mind a lot of questions. Why was it so important to include mostly Protestant religious education in a legally and explicitly secular New Zealand education system in the late 19th century? Why was a Victorian Scottish missionary explorer closely linked with British imperialism portrayed as a Christian icon to be admired and emulated by Canadian students in the mid-20th century? And why, oh why, would Australian educators adopt a curriculum made for a city more than 10,000 miles away in the late 1970s, long after the British Empire had begun the process of decolonization? The answer to these questions, I propose, is that settler colonialism and the Anglo world system profoundly shaped religious education in the public schools of Canada, Australia, and New Zealand from their founding moments to the period of decolonization following World War II. Now, in each case, local circumstances gave these systems unique features, but all of them experienced the transnational formative influence of empire. Throughout this talk, I'm going to be using James Bellich's concept of the Anglo world. He defines this as a politically and geographically divided, but economically and culturally united entity that was subglobal, yet transnational, intercontinental, and far flung. Bellich's chronology, definition, and overall framework closely paralleled what I found in my research at the State Library and elsewhere regarding religious education in the three case studies. And so for this reason, I'll be employing the term Anglo world throughout. His concept of the Anglo world, however, is vast, much larger than I studied for this project. In fact, much larger than it would have been possible for me to study in this project. I'm hoping that my project will spur on additional research to see how far the trends I've identified in these three case studies applied to other Anglo world settings. And I'd be happy to talk more about why I chose this framework and potential alternatives in the Q&A that we'll have after I finish my remarks today. I argue that the Anglo world system molded the subject of religious education in four primary ways. First, the Anglo world promoted a transnational imperial identity that scholars refer to as Britishness. Britishness regarded Protestantism as a moral core of this identity, of a Britannic identity. So there's this ideal that white Protestant settlers in Australia, Canada, and New Zealand were part of one imperial family, united by a common destiny and linked together in the British Empire. And that powerful identity really shaped the minds of policymakers as they went about the process of creating public education and indeed systems of religious education. The second primary influence of imperialism on religious education was through migration. Systems of religious education are designed to meet the needs of the local populace. But in the case of settler colonies like Australia, the local populace was, with the very important exception of indigenous peoples, artificially constructed through an intentional process of migrant selection. Migration was particularly influential in the mid-19th century as these systems of public education were being created and in the post-World War II era. Complicating the first two features I just noted, the third primary way that imperialism influenced religious education was through the extraordinary levels of Irish Roman Catholic migration and the explosive and controversial relationship between Britain and Ireland in the 19th and early 20th centuries. The large Irish Catholic presence in all three of my case studies challenged Protestant assumptions at the heart of Britishness, and the fears of radical Irish nationalism led to waves of anti-Catholic discrimination, and we'll see that in several different instances. And the final way in which empire affected the development of religious education was through everyday practices, practices of imitation, borrowing, and modeling, in their efforts to create what Bellich calls Neo-Europes and what many settlers called the goal to promote a better Britain or create a better Britain, settlers frequently copied things like education from Britain or from other Anglo world examples. And we'll see some examples of that kind of imperial sharing as we go in our talk today. So the rest of my talk is going to explore some of the key developments regarding religious education in the Anglo world, beginning with the foundational moments of public education in the late 19th century. I'll be going through three different countries in three different time periods, and you can see the rough chronology that I'll be making here. So I don't want you to get overwhelmed with detail. I really don't want you to sort of sweat the small stuff or get bogged down in the small stuff. The big picture here, what I'm really trying to convince you is that imperialism was intimately connected to religious education in the late 19th century, all the way through the era of decolonization, 1960s through the 1980s, when in some ways it's transformed in multiple places. But before we even get to the mid 19th century, we need to talk about the case of Ireland. The foundational problem faced by educators across the British Empire in the 1800s was the goal of making settler colonies in Australia, Canada, New Zealand. They wanted to create new unified societies, right? But though they were often populated with settlers from the British Isles, in all three of my case studies, they came from multiple Christian denominations. And of course, that doesn't even account for the non-Christian denominations or in other types of religious activity that were always present in Australia, Canada, and New Zealand, but were often simply ignored by policymakers. Religious education was, in fact, a major source of division. How could you create a united identity with so many different Christian denominations and other religions? And this is where Ireland sets the stage. Because the solution educators across the Anglo world and all of my case studies adopted came from the Emerald Isle. Historians of the British Empire often refer to Ireland as a laboratory of empire, and it certainly was that in the case of education. So we'll start today in 1831, when Lord Stanley, the English Chief Secretary for Ireland, created the Irish National System of Education. Critically, Lord Stanley's system made a distinction between secular and religious instruction, and actively promoted schools where Catholic, Anglican, and non-conforming students would receive education in the same environment. Secular, in this sense, did not mean completely free of religious ideals. And I'm going to return to that distinction a little bit more in a moment because it's very important in the Australian and New Zealand cases. The Irish national system favored Christianity, but it attempted to create a non-sectarian set of teachings that would be broadly acceptable to Christians of many denominations. The national system was, in essence, supposed to favor the establishment of schools by clergy from multiple Christian denominations, but that actually never really took place in Ireland. The vast majority of schools ended up under the control of a single denomination, determined largely by the demographics and geography of each region. But the Irish national system has an enormous impact on settler colonies of the British Empire, particularly in British North America and New South Wales. Public education in England doesn't arrive until four decades later, into the 1870s. So in the founding moments of our three case studies, they're looking to Ireland as one of the best examples that they could draw from an Anglo world setting. And we see direct connections between places in Canada and Australia to the Irish national example. So I'll start with, here's our middle picture here, Egerton Ryerson, known often as sort of the father of the Canadian education system. He traveled all across Europe in the 1840s, and he came away particularly impressed by the Irish national system. He wrote just vociferously and he loved the Irish national system, constantly mentioned it. In 1846, his Common Schools Act purposefully copied the Irish example. And the legislation that Ryerson made for Ontario, one of the largest British settler populations in Canadian provinces, was copied all across the other primarily English-speaking provinces of Canada as well. And in fact, it's actually facilitated by high levels of Irish migration. So we have a lot of Irish teachers, for instance, that are already familiar with the Irish national system that ended up becoming teachers in the Canadian setting. The Irish national system also proved a formative influence in the development of public education in Australia. Sir Richard Burke, an Anglo-Irish Protestant, became governor of New South Wales in 1830, and he subsequently proposed the creation of a school system modeled on the Irish national system. His measure didn't initially pass due to strong opposition from the Anglican Church, but after years of debate, New South Wales created a board of education in the 1840s that's remarkably similar to the Irish system. So, and then in turn, that New South Wales model is copied in other Australian states and colonies over time as well. So in an era when religion and education almost went universally hand in hand, the national system's original stated purpose, if not the reality, of creating a public school system for a society composed of multiple Christian denominations was significant. And the case of the Irish national system is a powerful example of the spread of educational ideals throughout the Anglo world. So we're gonna fast forward to what I'm calling the foundational moments of the 19th century in Canada, Australia, and New Zealand. And we're going to start with Canada, and I should apologize in advance. Canada is complicated. It's the most complicated case by far of all of the three places. And we should talk about why for a second. There are really two reasons we can point to. The first is the historical, linguistic, and cultural split between English-speaking and mostly Protestant Canadians, and French-speaking, but mostly Roman Catholic Canada. And then secondly, we have the British North America Act of 1867. So in about a month's time, when they celebrate Canada Day, they're celebrating this document. British North America Act is known as the Confederation Moment. It's where we get the name Canada from. And it joins the several provinces into this confederated union, but it contains specific provisions regarding religious education. All right, and here's some of the language on the screen right now. One of the things the Section 93, which is regarding education, says is education is going to be a provincial responsibility, so it won't be controlled by the federal government of Canada. But it also says, and I'll just quote here, nothing in any such law shall prejudicially affect any right or privilege with respect to denominational schools, which any class of persons have by law in the province at union. In other words, provisions for religious education at the moment of Confederation, and I should mention, not all of the provinces that are today part of Canada confederated in 1867. They could join it later as they voted to. But these provisions are constitutionally protected by the founding document of the Canadian Union. So this results actually in multiple different systems of religious education. There's different systems in each province. They all have their history. I explored them fairly at length in the book project. But I'll just maybe give you a couple of examples now. The most dramatic example is that of Newfoundland. Newfoundland doesn't join the Canadian Union until 1949. It's the last of the provinces to do so. But they had multiple publicly funded denominational school systems. So the Roman Catholic Church, Anglican, Methodist, Congregationalist, Presbyterian churches all had their own separate and publicly funded school systems. Later on, the Salvation Army and the Seventh-day Adventists also get their own public school systems as well. So this is a really complicated and indeed unique system, as far as my research shows me, in the Anglo world. In the interest of time, I will now commit the gravest and I think most common sin of Canadianists by focusing mostly on the populous provinces of Quebec and Ontario. But again, more examples can be found in the book if you want to follow up on that, or we could talk about it in the Q&A. Between 1841 and 1867, these two provinces at the time called Canada East and Canada West, and I know the terminology is complicated, I told you Canada was going to be complicated, were sharply divided on a number of issues. Religious education was one of the most contentious. The deadlock between Anglophones and Francophones on issues relating to religious education eventually resulted in the creation of distinct school systems based on linguistic and religious differences. For Ontario and Quebec, there emerged a division between a dominant common schools and a minority separate schools, and that this became the norm. Both of them would be publicly funded, but they'd be separated largely based on religion. So it depends on which of these places we're talking about. But after Confederation, the creation of these two distinct systems of education, relatively, by comparison, straightforward affair in Quebec. The system became entrenched with the Quebec Schools Act of 1869. And that act created two distinct committees on their Council of Public Instruction, one Catholic and one Protestant, with educational subsidies, so public monies, divided equally between both. But the situation was a lot more complicated in Anglophone Ontario, much more controversial. And here's another case where we see the influence of empire, right? That in Ontario, where you have this identity rooted in Britishness, they didn't really like the idea of funding a separate Roman Catholic school system. But Section 93 of the British North America Act kind of says that they have to. So the development of the separate school system became bitterly controversial in the 1850s and 1860s. And a major reason for that was the high level of Irish migration of those decades, largely prompted by the famine years in Ireland during the 1840s. So to many Protestant groups, the presence of so many Irish was a grave threat, and it stoked a lot of anti-Catholic sentiment at the time, and a lot of that was directed towards their separate schools, their Roman Catholic publicly funded schools. The bitterness and rancor surrounding the issue of separate schools did not fade away in the aftermath of Confederation. And debates about the proper amount of funding for separate schools continued to animate political controversy well into the 20th century. So we'll leave aside complicated Canada for a second, and we'll move on to the Australian example, one that maybe many of you are familiar with. Creating religious education in Australia was less complicated than in Canada, but just as controversial. Foundational statements in several Australian states include the phrase free, compulsory, and, here's our keyword, secular, as it related to Australian education. Despite the declaration of education as secular, religion maintained an active place in most Australian classrooms, and it continues to do so today. So the question that should be going through your heads right now is, how can educators say they're secular and yet still offer religious instruction in publicly funded classrooms? That seems like a pretty big problem. And here, I think the example of New South Wales is really illustrative. The colonial secretary, and later one of the architects of Australian Federation, Henry Parkes, was a key figure. He introduced an Education Act in 1866, the first sort of public schools act, or what became the foundation of modern day education in the state. And Parkes passed this controversial piece of legislation. The major stumbling block was religious education. And he offered a very particular definition of the word secular. So here you can see that definition right here. Secular was legally defined by this act as general religious teaching, as distinct from dogmatic or polemical theology. So in other words, you could teach Christianity as long as it didn't contain dogma or something that another denomination would take offense at. So secular really meant non-sectarian in that context. And because of this compromise, he was able to secure the vital support of the Anglican Church and thus pass this act. So the creative redefinition of the word secular is really critical to understand religious education in Australia and New Zealand, because a similar process happens there. And I think it leads to a really important point that we shouldn't think of secularity as a binary, right? You either are secular or you are not, but it's really a spectrum of potential relationships between church and state. Ultimately, in Australia, what we see is a difference between two ways of thinking about secularity, largely based on how they define the word secular in their founding education acts. So in New South Wales is a good example of a qualified secular system where we can read secular sort of more or less as non-sectarian. But we have another set of systems in Victoria, South Australia, Queensland, and in New Zealand that go a little farther on the spectrum of trying to separate religion from public education. They don't go all the way. Religious education is present in all cases in the Australian example in the 19th century. It continues to be so in most cases today. But they do go a little bit farther than the other examples. And I also wanted to mention that to Roman Catholics, neither one of these solutions is acceptable. And they rejected state-sponsored Christianity. They believed that proper Roman Catholic education needed to be administered by other Roman Catholics. And so they largely abandoned the public school systems and created a strong network of private schools, and simultaneously began about a century-long campaign to receive state aid for their schools. All right, now let's move on to our third case study, that of New Zealand. I mentioned this at the outset with our beginning examples, but the Foundational Education Act of 1877 was officially secular. And we can classify it as a strong secular system. So religion's not removed entirely, but it goes farther along the spectrum than some of these other examples in New South Wales. And that'll become important in our second period in a moment. There's a number of close parallels between what happens in New Zealand and the Australian examples. So we have broadly similar legislation and outcomes. Christian religious instruction is very much still in place in New Zealand classrooms. So the legislation passed in 1877, though, contains this strange legal loophole, or it will become a strange legal loophole over time. The law stated that education, and again, to quote it, it's during normal school hours, had to be secular. But it didn't specifically say that school buildings could not be used for religious instruction outside of the normal school timetable. So that led to the Nelson system that I referred to in the opening examples. six decades of religious education taking place outside of the regular class table. They just said, well, the school's officially over or school hasn't begun yet, so we can offer religious instruction now. It's a loophole that was never officially legal, or at least not until the 1960s. But this becomes known as the Nelson system. And it's largely designed to circumvent the secular provisions of the Education Act. Again, in all cases, this idea that we need religious instruction to provide a moral core for Britishness is very important. As in the case of Australia and Canada, the Irish Catholic population of New Zealand found the new secular education system unacceptable. And as in those two other Anglo world settings, Catholic leadership directed an enormous amount of energy into developing a private school network. So to conclude this first section on the sort of origins, the foundational moments of education here, we can conclude with a few major points. First, the Irish national system of education became a base template from which Anglo world settlers borrowed heavily and frequently. Second, the ability of Protestants to include religious education in the curriculum depended largely on their willingness to accept that the state could offer instruction in what we might think of as a generic or common Christianity, something that wouldn't ignite sectarian or denominational rivalries between Protestant variants. And then third, by the 1860s and 1870s, largely as a result of events in Ireland and within the Roman Catholic Church hierarchy, the Catholic stance in all Anglo world settings became entrenched against the form of state-sponsored but non-denominational education favored by many Protestants and pioneers in the Irish national system. So now our systems are set in place in this first chronological period, and we'll move to the second and see what happens in the era that James Bellich calls the era of recolonization. So for Bellich, recolonization occurs from the 1880s through the 1960s. I'm gonna break this up a little bit into two different parts there, and I'll explain why in a moment. According to Bellich, during this time period, Australia, Canada, and New Zealand grew closer to the empire, not more distant. So they strengthened ties here. And we see this in the case of religious education, where in many ways, they tried to strengthen the presence of religion in state-sponsored classrooms. Now, this era is typically overlooked in histories of religious education, but it deserves additional attention. What we see here are multiple pressure campaigns in the recolonization era, designed to achieve change and strengthen religious education systems. We see referenda, royal commissions, intense sectarian divides in all of our case studies. So I'm going to provide a few illustrative examples here. In Australia and New Zealand, it was the strong secular system. So those that went a little bit farther than the qualified system, such as New South Wales, where we see the most intense campaigns for religious education in the recolonization era. New Zealand, Victoria, South Australia, and Queensland all witnessed major efforts to alter or undermine the secular provisions of their governing education acts. A series of groups with the general title of Bible in Schools Leagues. And there are multiple Bible in Schools Leagues. They have slight variants in their names. I'm just gonna refer to them as Bible in Schools Leagues, or BISL, throughout. They formed independently of one another, but they often shared ideas and personnel over time. Especially in the Australian case, Bible in Schools Leagues tended to favor political referenda as the main goal to achieve their political ends. And indeed, South Australia's 1896 referendum on the subject of religious education is the first such political referendum in the history of Australia. In the cases of South Australia, Victoria, and New Zealand, we only see incremental changes in this period, but they'll experience change in and around the World War II years. Queensland, on the other hand, actually, after a successful referendum campaign, transforms fully from a strong to a qualified system of religious education much earlier. That happens in 1910. And to give you an example, I want to give you some of the flavor of what it would be like to sort of be, what these groups are saying and doing. Here's an example that comes right from the State Library of New South Wales, and I think a particularly powerful one. It comes from a group known as the Scripture Education League, formed in the 1890s. One of their major tactics was to emphasize ways in which Victoria was out of step with the rest of the Anglo world. So here's what they had to say, and it's a fairly lengthy quote, but it said, "We are unlike New South Wales. We are unlike mighty London. We are unlike all England. We are unlike Scotland, where there's not a parish without the Bible in the schools by the free vote of the people of the parish. We are unlike the United States of America with their 60 or 70 millions. We are unlike Canada. We are unlike Switzerland. We are unlike the best educated country in the world, Germany. but we are like France, whose atheistic secularism in the matter of education is a rebound from centuries of clerical and state oppression. That's the end of the quote there. This description and this pamphlet drew first upon Anglo world examples, and then it concluded with this unflattering comparison to French education to persuade Victorian citizens to lobby for more religious instruction. In New Zealand, the first bill to strengthen religious education came up for debate in 1885. That bill and the next 41 following it failed to pass in the New Zealand legislature. But New Zealand Bible and Schools Leagues continued to try. They continued to keep up these campaigns. And we see in New Zealand a really clear example of the interconnectivity of the Anglo world. They brought in one of these groups in 1913, brought in the Reverend Canon D.J. Garland to serve as their director, to lead a new campaign for change in New Zealand. Garland came to note actually in the Australian example where he led the referendum campaign to alter the secular provisions of Queensland back in 1910. So we see a lot of sharing between all these Anglo world sites. There's also bitter controversy over religious education in Canada during the era of recolonization as well. Manitoba here provides the most extreme example. By the 1870s, when Manitoba joined Confederation in Canada, they had a dual system of education, one for English-speaking Protestants and the other denominationally Roman Catholic. Migration in the 1870s, 80s, and 90s, though, was powered overwhelmingly by English-speaking Protestants. They outnumbered Catholics by 5-1 in the year 1900. In 1890, the provincial legislature passed two measures that effectively terminated the dual confessional system and abolished Roman Catholic school districts entirely. This move more or less obviously violated Section 93 of the British North America Act. They're not supposed to be able to do this. And it sparked an immediate outcry from Francophones across the country. The controversy came to be known as the Manitoba Schools Question. And it resulted in a long-lasting legal battle that went all the way to the Supreme Court of Canada and from there to the Privy Council of London, which was still the final court of appeals because empire. After winning the election, the Liberal leader Wilfrid Laurier, who had campaigned in the election of 1896 in large part on this issue, he forged what is known as the Laurier-Greenway Compromise with the Premier of Manitoba. The compromise allowed for Catholic religious education in schools where there was a substantial Catholic population and where local trustees petitioned for it. So in this early period from 1880s to World War I of recolonization, campaigns for change were not always successful, but the strength and persistence and sheer sort of controversy aroused by religious education across the Anglo world was impressive. And groups across the Anglo world are inspiring one another, they're learning from one another, they're adopting tactics from one another. Now, moving forward beyond the First World War, which in some ways sort of halts progress for a moment, but by the interwar period, a critical innovation appears first in England and Wales, and that's known as an agreed syllabus. An agreed syllabus is a curriculum for religious education based on principles to which multiple Christian denominations could agree. So it sort of gets past this issue of sectarian or denominational rivalry between Christian Protestant, largely Protestant groups. These are first developed following World War I, 1920s, and especially the 1930s, but they become a hallmark of English legislation in 1944 with the passage of the Butler Act. The Butler Act is one of the only significant pieces of social legislation passed during the Second World War in England and Wales. And the Butler Act said that religious education would be a mandatory subject in English and Welsh schools for the very first time, and that education would be taught according to an agreed syllabus. What we're going to see is this idea of the agreed syllabus sort of filters throughout all three of the case studies examined here. In 1944, for instance, the province of Ontario and their minister, George Drew, intentionally altered their religious education to more closely resemble the Butler Act. And another example of the transfer of educational practices across the Anglo world, the province of Ontario formally adopted the Cambridgeshire syllabus from England and implemented it in Ontarian schools. So they had no problem taking, again, a syllabus made for a different country and putting it in their schools because they all believed themselves to be British, right? It's meant for British people over there, it can work for British people here. This also happens in an Australian context. Victoria, the Australian state that had constructed one of the strongest secular systems in 1872, experienced a similar transformation of religious education in 1950, where they, again, came to a consensus around an agreed syllabus, And this group called the Council for Christian Education in Schools became responsible for administering religious education in the state. And the group is now called Access Ministries, but as far as I know, is continuing to do so in the state today. Now, New Zealand does not copy the legislation of the Butler Act, as we see in these other two examples, but they did strengthen religious education. And a critical moment here is in 1949, the Council for Christian Education formed, and it combined older organizations like the Bible and Schools League with the National Council of Churches. The very next year, the council created an agreed syllabus, and you can find a copy of that at the State Library as well. And it was modeled on English precedents, and then they engaged efforts to train teachers and train clergy that were offering religious instruction to teach based on this agreed syllabus model. With this new organization and a stronger set of educational materials, the Nelson system, remember, that's that quirky system that sort of schools early or open early or something, or open a little bit later, something like that, reached as many as 80% of students by the year 1962. And in that year, a Royal Commission on Education in New Zealand formally recommended that the Nelson system, for the first time, be made legal. And the New Zealand Parliament did that very soon thereafter, ending about ambiguity. So by the 1960s, it's formally legal based on an agreed syllabus teaching. And again, that system largely continues to today. So in this era of recolonization, religious education was either strengthened or maintained in all of the Anglo world settings that I looked at in my study. I should also note that this era continued the trend of not funding Catholic schools, except in cases in Canada where it was a legal requirement of the British North America Act. And in some ways, in some cases, that's complicated and controversial as well. Should we expand those Roman Catholic systems? And for the most part, Protestant groups say, no, we should not. So now we'll shift to our third and final chronological period, and that's the era of decolonization. So as the British Empire is on the way out, as the formal empire is sort of falling apart, we also see decolonization happening more on a cultural level throughout the Anglo world. Between the 1960s and 1980s, the landscape for religious education underwent a period of intense scrutiny and often transformation. Those fundamental things that held the Anglo world together no longer are as relevant in this era as they had been before. And we see consolidation. Is religious education just indoctrination? Are we comfortable with this in our classrooms? Changing demographics. We have people of multiple faiths now that we have to recognize, even though, again, religious pluralism has been around for a long time. Increasing secularization, shifting attitudes regarding the Catholic Church, the lessening of anti-Catholic sentiment, all of these made teaching religion in state classrooms an enormously difficult undertaking during these decades. In Australia particularly, they often relied on outside clergy coming in to offer religious instruction. This is known as special religious instruction. And this becomes a problem because, well, there's not as many people going to church, there's not as many churches, and they really struggle to find enough volunteers to teach in these classes. We see religious education come under review or be entirely transformed in Australia and Canada from the late 1960s through the 1980s. And there are basically three common outcomes to this process. First and most common were attempts to reform religious instruction with new teaching techniques. And these techniques are designed to provide information about religion rather than lead students towards religion. So taking a non-confessional approach towards the study and teaching of religion. Secondly, there are attempts to remove religious education entirely from the curriculum. Those are very rarely successful, sometimes through normal curricular methods and sometimes through litigation. They use the courts. And finally, there were some instances, such as in New Zealand or Queensland, where no major changes occur to established methods of religious education during this time period. So you can see some of the different processes that happen over time as well. And I'll get to some of these as we move forward. We've already mentioned the legalization system in New Zealand. It happens in 1962 or 63. Let's consider the example of South Australia. I found a lot of good sources in South Australia at the State Library of New South Wales. Why is the State Library of New South Wales collecting all this content on South Australia? I'm not sure, but I'm sure glad that they did. By 1968, falling church attendance meant that the system of religious education then in place, which needed church volunteers, was on the verge of collapse. And that year, the Methodist Church just withdrew from providing instructors to teach members, students of their faith. This Methodist action and their subsequent request ultimately led to a committee on religious education in state schools, often known as the Steinle Committee. Now, the Steinle Report, and here again, you can find a copy of the Steinle Report at the State Library, it advocated an educational course that would lead to open inquiry and not to the acceptance of any particular religious viewpoint. So again, they envisioned a system that taught about religion rather than any course that would lead to religion, that crucial distinction that educators were more and more likely to make across the Anglo world at this time period. But before they even had the chance to implement this system, controversy broke out in the state of South Australia. A secular humanist group called Keep Our State Schools Secular, COS, as they call themselves, formed that criticized the new course as a form of state-sponsored indoctrination. They said, this is inconceivable that our secular system of education should be secular, shouldn't have this kind of indoctrination going on. The group lobbied the Australian Labor Party to call for a new evaluation of religious education in the state. As a result of this continuing controversy, the new plan for religious education was never introduced on a mass scale in South Australia. Even as the traditional systems of religious education underwent transformation, another surprising development took place as denominational schools, and in particular Catholic private schools, began once more to receive direct state aid. And you can see a few examples of that listed here. This happens in Australia, New Zealand, and in some cases in Canada, although again, as usual, it's a little bit more complicated in the Canadian context. That this happened, that Catholic schools received state funding, was a sure sign that the assumptions of the late 19th and early 20th century Anglo world that were often based on Protestant religiosity and often on anti-Catholicism had significantly declined by the 1960s and 1970s. As the lights faded on the British Empire, an insistence on the necessity of a Protestant British identity carried increasingly less relevance, leading to some of these transformations. But I don't want to leave you today with the impression that the weakness of Britishness meant the end of inter-imperial sharing on education. In fact, even as decolonization progressed, Australian, Canadian, and New Zealander educators continued to look to each other and to Britain to help navigate the challenges of this era. So I'll conclude with the story of Alan Nins, the director of the Religious Education Project Team of South Australia. He was one of those creating that system of religious education I mentioned just a moment ago that started so much controversy. In 1976, he received a grant to travel abroad to study trends in religious education in other countries. He ended up visiting the United States, Canada, and the UK. Nins noted the parallel developments occurring in each of his case studies and concluded, he said, there's more that we can learn from the English situation than from North America. In other words, we're more similar to England than we are to the United States. But he said, we are part of a trend common to a large part of the English-speaking world, a trend that is gaining momentum, a trend to introduce the study of religion on education grounds alone. So from Nins's perspective, this new wave of educational philosophy is a Anglo world phenomenon as late as the mid-1970s. The Anglo world approach to religious education, it seems, survived even as the empire within which it was built collapsed. Now, I want to end today with a word of thanks to the State Library of New South Wales. My presentation today and the monograph that it draws from is deeply influenced by my time spent both researching and writing the facilities that the State Library provided in my time as the 2019 Australian Religious History Fellow. The librarians, the resources, the facilities were all extraordinarily helpful, and they played a major role in my ability to complete this project. So thank you all. Thank you for listening to my talk today. And I believe we have some time for some questions and answers.
Thanks so much, Stephen. That was a terrific talk. And it was a pleasure to host you at the library. You were with us for all too brief a period of time, I think. I think you would have found a few extra things in stack if we'd kept you for a bit longer. We do have some questions coming through. First up is, Canada really is complicated. The situation in Newfoundland with so many school systems, is that still the case today with those many concurrent school systems running in that province?
No, and in fact, it becomes a major source of controversy in the 1980s and 90s. there start to be, so educators complain about that system a lot. They say there's too many systems, it doesn't make sense. We don't have enough people to support this many systems. So there's been that critique for a long time, but we actually start to see a lot of change with some sex abuse scandals in the Roman Catholic Church, but in other cases as well, that leads to sort of a public outcry against some of these denominational schools. And it leads to a referendum in the case of Newfoundland much later. I think it's in the 1990s. And then they do transform that system. So they create a single state-sponsored system of education. But there was an argument and an outcry from the Roman Catholic Church in particular that this violated Section 93 of the British North America Act, similar to what we've seen in other cases across Canada. But there was a lot of movement there.
We have another question about the Catholic school system, this one focused on the Australian situation. So this person is writing that obviously this begins with the Irish migration to Australia, but is maintained by European migration and others after World War II. And they go on to write, do you see this system as a point of resistance to the idea of empire? And how do you see this private system interacting with a public, traditional public schooling system?
Yeah, absolutely. I think there's a lot of evidence to suggest that the preservation of this Irish Catholic or Roman Catholic, but largely Irish private school system really helped preserve their identity all the way into the mid 20th century and became sort of critical. And it is, again, a source of resistance to this idea that to be British meant to be Protestant. And their lobbying campaigns for state aid are very important throughout the time throughout this entire time period for over a century until success they achieved state funding in the 1960s.
We've got a couple of speculative questions here about the future of religious education in schools. So the first one is around, do you think there is a future for this type of education in a state school system?
I think that's a really important question, and it's a question that's as controversial today as it's been throughout this entire time period. I hope at the very least I provided some context to say, if we're having controversies today, that's nothing new, and maybe it's even kind of healthy, right, to talk about what should the relationship of the state be in providing religious education. I think there's a powerful argument to say that an education is incomplete without some understanding of religion. You have to understand, you can't understand human activity without understanding how powerful religion has been as a shaping force throughout history and in today's politics. So how do we do that without slipping into indoctrination? I think that's a really important question. Mm-hmm. And there's lots of different answers to that. In Australia, we still have a system largely on special religious instruction where outside clergy volunteers can come in and administer religious education. In the UK, it's still a mandated subject taught by state paid teachers. The United States, where I live, it's not really allowed. It's kept out. Religion only really shows up in history textbooks and in a couple of other examples where we talk about it more in generalities. So I don't have the answer. I think there's multiple answers, but I think it's important that we keep asking the question.
And you've sort of touched on the answer to this next question just then. What benefits of religious education in state schools have you found in your research?
Well, I mean, in the time periods that I'm talking about, I think it's very clear that the religious education is intimately tied to identity. It's a core part of who people think they are. And when we talk about what is education designed to do, it's designed to give our young people everything they need to be successful citizens of tomorrow. And so it's a really critical part of identity. And as I said, I would say sort of the academic argument today would be, again, how can you possibly understand what's happening in the world and be prepared to participate in a democratic system without some understanding of religion? And I would hope that today, and we see that this shift happening in a lot of places, that it's not simply education only about Christianity, but it's education about world religions. So you can really understand multiple different religious traditions rather than simply one.
Really important. And another historical question has come in. So you mentioned that there were obviously systems of faith in Canada, Australia, and New Zealand before colonization, and that those systems were largely ignored by policymakers. Were there any conversations that you've come across in your work where there were attempts to perhaps acknowledge those systems?
Virtually none. And this is, I think, a sad part of the story. So in most of the cases, treating First Nations or Aboriginal peoples would have been the responsibility of the federal government rather than the provincial governments. So many of the state or provincial legislatures that I'm looking at, they're not really involved in this process at all. But the overwhelming tendency in education in the 19th century, and all three of the case studies here, is assimilation. It's if you want to succeed in our society, you got to look and talk and have faith like us. And so they don't want to promote other religions. They don't have this idea of inclusivity or pluralism that I think has become much more commonly accepted today.
Well, thank you so much. It was a terrific talk. And I think that everybody who came along today has learned quite a bit about the context. I think we often have controversy, but not a lot of context. So thank you very much for distilling so much work, many years, I suspect, of research into a very neat 40-minute presentation for us. Congratulations on the book. Do try and find the book. We'll make sure that we have that book at the State Library of New South Wales for anybody who is really keen to read more of Stephen's work. But do join us next time in the Scholar Talk series. So next time we'll have Dr. Mark Dunn. Mark was the 2016 CH Curry Fellow, and he'll be talking about Aboriginal Newcastle. In another good news story, his book from his fellowship was released today. The Convict Valley is available now from Allen and Unwin, and you can read my new review on the Convict Valley at dictionaryofsydney.org, a website of the State Library of New South Wales. So until then, thank you very much, Stephen, for a really terrific and very engaging presentation. Thank you to everybody who came, and I hope to see you next time at a Scholar Talk. Bye-bye.
Thank you.